My name is Ted Shuart. I'm the Schoharie County historian, a longtime Civil War buff. I've been a Civil War reenactor for 37 or 38 years. And some years back, Ann Hendricks of Schoharie, she's the Schoharie historian and the deputy county historian. Ann approached me and handed me a diary, and it was from a Civil War soldier. And naturally, I was thrilled, any diary is a treasure. And when I got it, I started flipping through it, and it looked pretty interesting. I put it aside. I figured I'd sit down and transcribe it when I had time. Ann said she didn't remember where she got it. She was a little girl, about 4 years old, when someone gave it to her. So there's no name written in the diary, just the inscription, "My dear Brother Will, Christmas 1861, and signed Joe." And then when I started reading into it, I realized that Will was in the Signal Corps. And that was really exciting. There's somewhere between 1.2 million and 2 million men fought in the American Civil War on the Union side. Less than 2,000, something like 1,780 enlisted men, I don't know how many officers, somewhere around 2,000 men were in the Signal Corps during the entire war. At the time I was given the diary, no Civil War diary from the Signal Corps had ever surfaced. There was a book done in 1898, I believe, the Signal Corps USA and the War of the Rebellion by J. Willard Brown, and that contained some entries from diaries, but that's the book on the American Civil Corps, really, in the Civil War, and no diaries. And ironically, about the year Ann gave me the diary, the first ones surfaced. It was the Civil War diary of a man named Captain Fortescue. Very quickly, it became history book of the year. So anyhow, it was exciting to find out he was in the Signal Corps. On the other hand, he never wrote his name in the diary. So I started going through it, and it starts off rather slow, January 1st, naturally. And I finally realized I just started writing down the names of all the officers he mentioned over the next month or so. And by that, I was able to find out that he was in the 30th Pennsylvania, which later became the 66th Pennsylvania. And finally, the only officer never mentioned by name by him was William H. Hill himself. So then I had William H. Hill, and I looked into it, and I was right. So now I had his name. And then I was happy to find a photograph, not a great one, but it's one out of the Signal Corps book. And anyhow, so William H. Hill, I was hoping he was from Schoharie County or a New Yorker, but he wasn't. He was from Philadelphia. He's about 22 years old when he enlisted in the 30th Pennsylvania Infantry in the summer of 1861. This is a time of extreme confusion. The war has just started. The Army, the entire United States Army at that time, I think including all branches, was somewhere as 25 or 30,000 people distributed all over the country. Suddenly Lincoln's calling for 90,000 volunteers, then 300,000 more, and then 300,000 more. And the states are furnishing men in uniforms at first, but it becomes very quickly, there's a fierce competition for recruiting. And anyhow, so it happens, as I read into this, Will is in a regiment that is just falling apart. So when he enlisted, there were about 800 men in the 30th Pennsylvania. There are no uniforms, and mustering was delayed. So about 400 men quit their ranks to join other units. Now they're down to 400. They finally start consolidating, and then a leading citizen of Philadelphia by the name of Benjamin Berry purchased uniforms for the 400 men remaining. Unfortunately, there's no blue cloth, so they had gray uniforms. And a man named John Patrick was designated lieutenant colonel of the regiment, and they formed a battalion of five companies and went to Washington, D.C. under Colonel Chandry. And at that time, they redesignated the 66th Pennsylvania, and they're assigned to General Abercrombie's brigade of General Banks Division stationed in Frederick, Maryland. And a few more men go to the front. They don't do anything for the whole year but stay in camp except 3 days where they do some picket duty on the Potomac. And so anyhow, Will's diary begins on New Year's Day, 1862. He's received a holiday box from home delivered by Adams Express. That in itself is a neat little tangent to go on. Adams Express is still a big company today. Started in 1837. They got so big that they actually delivered payroll to both sides during the Civil War. That blew my mind that they're actually working for both sides and nobody seems to care. Anyhow, they're one of the oldest companies on the stock exchange. So anyhow, he's got an Adams Express box. He's homesick. He declined an invitation to a party, but he does visit with the chaplain and the major to share some of the goodies from his box. And I find a second lieutenant, Company G. He's called up to testify at a court-martial of a fellow officer named Allen. And again, this regiment is a mess. He makes several trips to Frederick during the week, and he mentions the bad character of the regiment's officers. And also, he's got an obsession with keeping an account of all his expenditures with this fund. He lists everything he buys, everything he spends for the whole year, and he also writes down the time he goes to bed every night. He's also a regular church goer. He's an Episcopal, and he hates missing church, and it's a recurring theme in the diary. So Will and two other officers put up about $10 apiece, about $1,000 today each, and they build a cabin. They have a housewarming party, and it's usual camp stuff, more about the court martial. Meanwhile, he's trying to get, he wants to be an aide on General Abercrombie's staff, Abercrombie being the brigade commander, and he apparently knows Abercrombie. So he's worried, very worried, and he writes this down a lot. He's really worried about taking this exam. It gets put off. And meanwhile, the regiment is continuing to fall apart. General Abercrombie kind of gets him out of that, and he sends him to his hometown, Philadelphia, to arrest two deserters. And so he gets to spend a week at home. So you get to meet Will's family through 10 days of diary entries. He's got a girlfriend named A. That's all he refers to her as A. He breaks up with A. Very traumatic, apparently. His diary entry at the end of that day says all for the best. And he slashes the pen all the way across the page on the T on best. But then they reconcile, they see each other every day of the week. And it's kind of this little soap opera. And meanwhile, he finally has to leave. The sergeant and his party don't show up for the train. He's got his two deserters. He locks them up at the station, leaves his baggage with the black porter for the weekend, goes home for two more days, and finally brings the deserters back, where the prisoners get drunk on the train. It's an interesting story. And now Will, meanwhile, is enchanted by a beautiful mute. He calls a beautiful woman on the train. So that's a theme, too. He mentions a lot of girls. So anyhow, on the 6th, the colonel, the captain, four lieutenants resign. Will is, again, just removed from all this by Abercrombie and sent to Newmarket, Maryland to arrest a deserter. And then meanwhile, he buys a horse named Dash from the captain. He's really happy with the horse. So it's going on, you know, winter in camp. There's a grand review in Frederick. The regiment is now under the command of a captain. He performs poorly. Abercrombie's not impressed. And finally, on March 1st, the regiment's disbanded. They had been called to Washington. The men become mutinous, and the men are distributed in the 73rd Pennsylvania, except for two companies that are put in the 99th Pennsylvania. Will, our Lieutenant Hill, is in the G Company, which goes to the 99th Pennsylvania. And he will be, for the rest of the war, he will be associated with that regiment. Even though he's in the Signal Corps, all his records will be in the 99th Pennsylvania and till 1865. So finally, Will, who's been talking about nothing but this aide ship being an aide to General Abercrombie, discovers it's too late. And when he goes down to inquire about it, it's one of those things that's like, you were interested in that, huh? And they just blow him off. So now he's in a regiment that's falling apart, afraid he might not lose his appointment as an officer. He goes to Philadelphia's hometown and meets with the governor. So again, apparently Will is pretty well connected. And then he goes back to Washington and he has a lot of free time. He goes to Willard's Hotel for entertainment. And then acting on a tip on March 20th, Will calls on Major Myers of the Signal Corps. And Myers apparently likes him, tells him to come back the next day, and he's taken right in for the tests. And off on a tangent, there is Will's diary, as Ann gave it to me. It had a pencil attached to it with a string. I still have the pencil, but it came off while I was reading it, and the binding broke a little. Other than that, it's in beautiful condition. There's the entry that was my only clue as to who he was, Will, and his brother Joe. And you can see some of the diary entries. Will is actually a really, he spells very well. He writes well. I got some spelling issues in that, but he's actually, this was a joy to transcribe, really. Some handwriting issues, especially with personal names and place names. But other than that, he's a real good writer. I'd also, you'll see on the bottom of the one page, probably R102, took me forever. That's on every entry. It finally, after I was done with the diary, I had this epiphany. It's retired at 20 after 10. And that's what he does. He writes down every night, what time he went to bed, at least for the first half of the diary. And you can see a little closer. I like this here. I don't know if you can read it on your screen, but called on Miss Blanchard, don't like her. Yeah, he doesn't hold back. It's his diary, and he doesn't like anybody. I don't know how many entries I've read where he says, met so-and-so, didn't like him. So again, it's kind of a recurring theme. General Abercrombie. He's the brigade commander in Banks' division. He's also got two young daughters that will become intrigued with. And when they're in Washington, he spends several days with them. And so here we are, the Signal Corps. It's founded by Major Albert J. Myers, and he was born in Newburgh, New York in September 1827. And the family moved to Western New York when he was little. His mother died. And but he had a good upbringing by her sister, and he got acquired an education in medicine. And while he was in medical school, he wrote a thesis titled Sign Language for Mutes. And so he very early was a pioneer in sign language for the deaf. He practiced medicine for 3 years, and then he decided to enlist in the Army. So as an assistant surgeon, he gets the rank of major. And he really quickly became interested in military and naval signals. So he was stationed in New Mexico. This is in the late 1850s, and where he saw Comanche signaling with lances from hilltop to hilltop. And that fascinated him. So he devised a signal system and presented it to the War Department. And they, of course, being the Army, they waited 2 years before he finally heard anything. By then it's 1860 and the Civil War is about to break out. Or 1858, it's getting close. So in 1858, experiments were performed, and he was assisted by two junior officers. They were, one was Lieutenant Walworth Jenkins from the 1st Artillery, and Second Lieutenant E. Porter Alexander of the Corps of Engineers. That will be very important later. Both these guys are smart. If you're in the artillery or the engineers, you're top of your class. And he gives them a couple of whiz kids as assistants. And he reports in August 1860. Now we're 4 months away from South Carolina seceding from the Union for the start of the Civil War. But he's out in New Mexico, and now they're chasing Navajos. And even though it's a brief campaign, there's and with only limited opportunities to test signals, it's still considered a great success. The equipment's easily transferred, boarded over the worst terrain, and the Signal Corps men are sending messages and receiving messages up to 20 miles. So it's working really well. And now we come into the beginning of the Civil War. It's been called the first modern war. It's first war to employ repeating rifles, machine guns, ironclad ships, use of railroads by the military, first field hospitals, and the first signaling by flag and torch, first use of portable telegraph on the battlefield, and first military reconnaissance from the manned balloon. And so Will is going to get involved in all of this. And so now what happens, Albert Meyer, the founder. Now what happens is the Battle of First Bull Run comes along. And as a history buff, it's always frustrated me. The Yankees should have won that battle. They were winning all day. They bluffed Confederate General Beauregard. He was sure they were going to hit him on the right. Well, they swept around very cleverly to the left, and they really should have won, except that E. Porter Alexander, who had been Albert Meyer's assistant in Mexico, had gone with the Confederacy. And as the United States military had yet to adopt the Signal Corps, Porter Alexander was right on it, and the Confederates had a Signal Corps, which means there's a famous moment in the Battle of First Bull Run where a Signal Corps crew on a high position sends a signal, look out, your left is turned, and it changes the whole battle. The Yankees are coming from the left, they blunt the attack, they win, and all of a sudden, the United States Army now realizes they really need a Signal Corps. Their entire battle plan had been foiled by a party of about six men on a hilltop. And so August 1st, several weeks after the battle, Myers is submitting plans for a new Signal Corps. His proposal is endorsed by McDowell and McClellan, and organization of the Signal Corps begins almost immediately. And they got various camps opening, and the most famous one was at Red Hill in Georgetown, Virginia. And originally the men, they were just grabbing enlisted men from the Pennsylvania Reserves and assigning them to the Signal Corps until the, you know, again, it's all in its early stages. And First Lieutenant Samuel Cushion of the 2nd United States Infantry had been Meyer's assistant in New Mexico and was one of the officers selected for service. I think he'll become basically a second in command. So they call for 22 sets of men. Each one is two officers and four enlisted men. They get flags, they get rockets, colored lights, and Beardsley's new flying electric telegraph, which is kind of a neat thing. A man named Frederick Beardsley shows up with his son, Fred Jr., and they have a brand new telegraph. It doesn't require the heavy batteries and the heavy battery wagon of a normal telegraph, and you don't need to know Morse code. It's got a brass disc, and you just flip the disc to different number letters, and a man in a day or two, anybody can become proficient with this machine and send telegraph messages on the field. So this is a brand new thing, and starts training on that immediately. He also starts boarding at Hommeler's house in Georgetown. That's another little interesting tangent. There were a family. They originally had a bunch of slaves. They freed them, emancipated them early in the war. But for some reason, they just, who they knew, I don't know whether they knew Myers, but they took in all sorts of Signal Corps men. So it was traditional for officers of the Signal Corps to board at Hommeler's. And they have a daughter named Sue, 18 years old. We'll hear a lot about Sue in the next month. But meanwhile, Will begins training for the Signal Corps at Red Hill. And it's considered a great location because it has a clear view 20 miles into Northern Virginia, which is about the range of a normal signal station. And Red Hill has been called the birthplace of the United States Signal Corps. So he's examined, he passes his test, and he's in. So Anyhow, on May 6th, he's called into the field. He gets on a boat. He's going down to Fortress Monroe. General McClellan is beginning the famous Peninsula Campaign. And he's joined by Mr. Beardsley, the inventor of the field telegraph, and Fred Jr. at Aquia Creek, and they travel together. And Will is put in the command of Captain Wonderly, who's moody, drinks a lot, he's rude, and he's argumentative, and he's sick a lot. So you get some interesting diary entries about Wonderly, Captain Wonderly. But anyhow, on May 16th, Lieutenant Hill reports at McClellan's headquarters at the White House on the river, which is, I think I have a picture of that actually. Where the signal for camp. Now these I can go back into. These are just some pages from the book. And you can see here, yeah, actually just do aside here. It's a very simple technique. It's just straight up is five, which is means, you know, end of word, end of two fives is end of sentence or a word sentence, and three is the end of the message. So five straight up is no letters. And then it's just one, two, three, and four, and a number of them. And then they work mostly from abbreviations. And so these guys, they're sending some pretty sophisticated messages very quickly. Meanwhile, they've got these very powerful telescopes called the marine glass, and they can easily pick somebody up at 20 miles if the weather conditions are right and watch them with the flag and the signaling. There's also different colored flags. Normally white with a red is used, but if you're way up against the sky, white might get lost in the sky, then you use a black. Artillery normally uses red, and the Navy. So that's all in the book. And here we are, Fortress Monroe at the in Chesapeake Bay. And this is where Will reports first, and before going up the peninsula. He also mentions the Hygieia Hotel. He eats there frequently. I think you can see that in the foreground. If you Google that, it's pretty famous. Here we are. Let me just, here we go. Here's the White House. And this is actually the White House in Washington, D.C. is supposedly named for this building. This belonged to the George Washington family. And of course, Lee had married into the Custis Washington family. And I believe this was the home of his son, Fitzhugh. And so it was treated by great respect by the Union, knowing it's one of Washington's houses, and it's very historic. Unfortunately, when the Union evacuated, it burned to the ground. No one knows whether they torched it or if it was an accident. You can see the ladder on the roof. That's probably for Signal Corps men, I would guess. But there is a station right here. There's the aforementioned E.P. or Alexander, the founder of the one of the founders of the Confederate Signal Corps, and Meyer's assistant in New Mexico as a young lieutenant. So, let's see. So what happens is that for the first time they're using the telegraph, and here's a good portrait of them running out the wire. They run out literally miles of wire. I think a spool, I don't know what it is, a mile, 2 miles, but they run out miles of it, and it's working pretty well, except Will's diary reflects the frustration of having the wire cut repeatedly. And May 23rd, he's running out the wire cut, took in at 3 o'clock. May 24th, ran wire from Smith's headquarters to Davidson's, 1 mile, wire cut, mended, run all night, wire cut all night, and so on. And what's happening is nobody knows what this is. There's tens of thousands of Yankee soldiers in the peninsula, and they're running these wires through the countryside. And Yankee soldiers kept cutting pieces out and running to their commanding officers saying, look what I found. You know, something that they didn't know if it was some explosive. Anyhow, so the Yankee soldiers themselves keep cutting it. They're cutting souvenirs. And so finally, all the men at roll call, a general order has to be read to leave the wire alone. And meanwhile, they have to post guards on the wires now. And eventually they straighten the mess out. And so it's kind of comical. It's not the Confederates cutting it, it's their own men because they don't know what the heck it is. So anyhow, finally, wire cut, men did run all night, May 25th and so on. And so eventually he's running pretty well. He's also gets, mentions he meets the Duke de Chartres. I have a picture of him later on. It's the French royal family, royalty. They're military observers that are traveling with McClellan's army. So he's meeting a lot of people. He also, on one night, he mentions the thrill of looking down on a camp of 25,000 men. And Fortescue's diary, the book that came out in 2015, has the same entry. He's just amazed looking down on a camp of 25,000 men at night and that. So anyhow, something really exciting happens eventually. And this is, well, these are your typical stations. You try to get as high up as you can. I'll go back to them. The balloon. And here's another sideline that down at the peninsula, they're having a real problem. They have all these signal corps men and they got the wire, but they can't see anything. It's very flat and it's mostly forested. And you can get up to the highest trees and really not see anything. So what they are doing, like at White House, they have a signal man on the roof of the house, and they're signaling to gunboats, and the gunboats are passing information down the shoreline, but they really can't do anything. And so Thaddeus Lowe comes into the picture, and he's got the brand new balloon corps, which is fascinating in its own right. And so he brings the balloon to the peninsula, and they very quickly turn things around. This balloon is a curse to the Confederates. They can't do anything without being seen. And at one point, even they're actually looking into the city of Richmond. They can see carriages and people walking in the streets. Eventually, the Confederates, they blow up at least one cannon trying to shoot this down. And they actually sneak a battery to within a mile of it and get sharpshooters. And by now, everybody's having so much fun with this thing, besides, you know, lending great assistance to the army. It's a thrill for the public. And one day, Lowe brings up a famous New York reporter into the balloon. And at the time, the Confederates found the range. So all of a sudden, there's sharpshooter bullets whacking the basket and going through the rigging. And then a shell bursts up very close. They get it down with no issue. The reporter is unconscious, he faints. And it's kind of unfortunate. McClellan says, no more of that, no more taking up tourists. It's just military from now on. And it's too bad because one of the guys waiting for a ride was Ferdinand von Zeppelin, Count von Zeppelin, who would be famous, he was fascinated with this and was always there. And of course he's the founder of the Zeppelin later in Germany. So, anyhow, on June 1st, they decide for the first time to put a man in the balloon and run the telegraph wire up and telegraph information from the balloon. And you can see this here where they're doing it. It's just great that the photographer was there to capture the moment. And it's Will in the balloon. Will is the guy sending the messages down on June 1st, 1862, for the first time. And it's in his diary entry that night. He may or may not be in this group of people here. So anyhow, on June 4th, he's even asked to submit a report on Beardsley's magneto-electric machine, and he gives it a favorable review. And by now the wire is working great. Under orders from Myers, Will crosses the Chickahominy on the Grapevine Bridge, which is Bridge Sumner's Corps would later use during the battle. And it's a rickety bridge. It's a pretty good bridge until the floodwaters hit it. But you'll read about and see many images of the Grapevine Bridge. And so now he's on the other side of the river. And suddenly he's ordered to reel up and recross the Chickahominy back over the bridge, back in stages back to Cold Harbor. And finally, on June 28th, he writes, "The enemy chased us across the Chickahominy." And of course, the soldiers in the field never know what's going on. They're being told this is a change of base and that. Meanwhile, one of the lieutenants leaves all the poles for the wires on the wrong side of the bridge. They're ordered to go back and get it, and close to being captured and that. But finally, on June 30th, Will writes, "We're whipped and this is a retreat." So they remain. Anyhow, the next about 6 weeks are pretty inactive. He stays with the Signal Corps in the Lower Peninsula until mid-August. The only thing of note is a corporal is near him is killed one day by artillery fire. And he takes part in a couple of scouting expeditions. Otherwise, that's mostly daily routine life, visiting friends in other camps, in the hospital. And finally, they go back to Fortress Monroe. And then from there, on August 28th, they're back to Alexandria, Virginia. And then he's put on station, signal station on Miner's Hill nearby at that point. And from there, they can hear the fighting of the Battle of Second Bull Run not long after that, or at about that same time. And he stops back in Homelers, where he had boarded when he was in school. He sees Sue, and then he's sets out to Frederick, Maryland, where he reports to General Sumner on September 12th. And this is now the Antietam Campaign, and this is just a couple of days before the Battle of South Mountain. So on the 15th, Hill establishes a station on South Mountain, and I thought this was remarkable. I've driven from Frederick to Harper's Ferry. They only have one station between that. They can send a message from Frederick to South Mountain, and then from South Mountain to Harper's Ferry. And it's quite a distance, 40 miles, and they're just sending messages back easily, which to me was pretty neat. On the 16th, Harper's Ferry surrenders. Lieutenant Hill learns about that. And anyhow, he's moving west. And to me, this is like the most exciting part of the book. On September 16th, he establishes a signal station on the roof of the Philip Pry House, overlooking the Antietam Creek. And shortly later, General McClellan rides up and makes it his personal headquarters. And Will wrote, "The battle was planned by the generals on my station." So on 5 p.m., he goes out and he takes a position he sent out on the right. And his message is, it's kind of neat, whether he forgot his dispatch book or he decided to write him in his diary later, but he hadn't done this before. He's writing his official messages as he's receiving and sending them by semaphore, by the flags, signal flags, and in the back of his diary, in the pages of the back. And so he writes, he sends to General Marcy from General Hooker on the field, "The enemy are moving a battery to our right. Our aim is good. The enemy have stopped serving their guns on the right. The enemy's batteries are effectively silenced. The two guns taken from the front are being placed in position opposite our right, making a battery of 4-pounders at that point. They are apparently light 12-pounders. That's quite a message for flags and that. But they were, again, apparently very proficient at that. Then he gets a message from General McClellan. "What force of infantry do you see?" And he replies, "A regiment of infantry supporting the batteries on the right is all that's visible." That's kind of important too, because you read that later, Lee was bluffing up there. He didn't have anything up there. Hooker is probing. The attack is going to start there the next day. And Lee's moving guns and stuff all over, just, trying to make it look strong. But the battle will start there the next day, but nothing happens that night. So it's kind of neat to see Will is reinforcing what I've read in history books. Now, the Battle of Antietam. He sent out the next day with General Sumner as his personal signal man. This is overlooking Antietam, another signal station. And this is Owens. Most of these guys he mentions by name in the book. So there's names under the caption. I knew at least half of these guys. So it was fun. So here's Will. He's with General Sumner as his personal flagman. So this is the second phase of the attack at Antietam on September 17th. General Sumner is advancing with Sedgwick's division across the field. You can see the three long blue lines on the right center. He's supposed to be joined by Franklin's division and Richardson's divisions, which are of equal size, and they're supposed to link on his right. And meanwhile, he advances, pushes these forces before him, advances through the woods, and the Confederates hit him on the right flank and just roll him up. It's a disaster. They can't turn around. They can't face the enemy. And they finally have to retreat off to the right. So Will is in the middle of all of that. So you'll see in the background here, or you know, on the right is the East Woods. General Mansfield of the 12th Corps had just been wounded and would die that night. And Will would be somewhere around here, probably with Sumner in the middle behind the third line, advancing very close to that. And so anyhow, they're the first ones, I think, to send the message that Mansfield's wounded. So he writes, General Hooker is wounded, who he had been too, and General Sumner is in command. The fighting is desperate, but we are steadily driving them. And then at 10:15, Will writes to McClellan, I am from Sumner. I am hunting from French and Richardson, French and Richardson's divisions and cannot find them. If you know where they are, send them to me. To McClellan, 5 minutes later, must have reinforcements immediately or we'll give way on the right. And then General Mansfield is wounded. And then reinforcements have arrived but are not yet engaged. So it's kind of neat that this is all coming from General Sumner. He, you know, in the midst of all this, and as I said, Will is somewhere down there in the middle of the third line. He sleeps on the field with Sumner, and the next day he just writes to General McClellan, all is quiet this morning. The enemy's cavalry pickets are in front of me, Sumner. So that ends Antietam. The Confederates withdraw across the river. And he'll go down to Harper's Ferry with General Sumner's corps. He likes Sumner, and he calls him a clever old man. He really seems to enjoy Sumner, who is an interesting officer. There's one of the oldest generals in the army called Bull Sumner, the Bull of the Woods. They said you could hear his voice all over the battlefield. It didn't matter how much firing was going on. And it was called Bull because during the Mexican War, a musket ball bounced off his head, Bull Sumner. And anyhow, not a great commander, good corps commander, not a great commander, but a good corps commander. And Will just really seems to admire him. As I said, he calls him a clever old man. So he stays at Harper's Ferry through October, manning the stations on Bolivar Heights and Loudoun Heights. And he meets a local family named Gardner and takes a lot of meals there. They have a son who's sick. He gets some medicine, finds him something called Shanks syrup and brandy. So he seems to really care for this family and helps them out. And on November 13th, General McClellan is done as commander of the Army of the Potomac, and he's replaced by Ambrose Burnside. Anyhow, now Hill and his party, they set out for Falmouth, Virginia, right opposite Fredericksburg, Virginia. And Will takes part in the December 13th Battle of Fredericksburg. On December 11th, 2 days before the battle, he's sent to Burnside's headquarters at the Phillips House, where he's put on the telegraph again. And on December 13th, he's sent to order to General Franklin's headquarters near the Bernard House. And he's there when General Bayard is killed by a shell. He writes about that. That's a well-documented moment during the battle. He said the Confederates were shelling the woods around the house like crazy. He was in the woods the whole time, and then he witnessed a shell bursting near Bayard, General Bayard, and killing him. Anyhow, he remains in camp. It's a great loss for the Union, Fredericksburg. They fall back across the river to Falmouth Heights and stay there. He remains in camp until December 28th. And suddenly, I love the way this diary ends, because again, I only have 1 year of his diary. I don't know what happened after that. But he will remain in camp until December 28th. And he's suddenly surprised when he won a raffle that he didn't know he entered. He gets a leave of chance, packs his valise, and heads for Washington. He arrives at Hommeler's house in Georgetown, where he had boarded when he was going to school. They have the beautiful daughter, Sue, but she's not home. He has supper, retires for the night, and at 4 o'clock in the morning, Mr. Hommeler gives him a ride to the train depot, where he catches the 6 o'clock train for Philadelphia, arrives in the morning, and now we know the girl he's referred to as A all the time. Her name is Ada. You know, it's Ada does not seem to care much for me. Glad of it. And his final entry is style. He goes to the opera, and then he ends with Styles gave me a pipe to smoke. It made me sick. So that's all I have on Will. I do know that in a little bit, through going through the history books, of course, he remains with the Army, is promoted to captain at the Battle of Gettysburg. He is put on Culp's Hill, and that is it's called the Rock Station. It's a very important post at Culp's Hill. And at some point during the war, Will is wounded, and he resigns in January of 1865. There's not much on pension or anything, but he dies at the age of 42, 20 years later. Whether it's from results of his wound or what, I don't know. So, but anyhow, it's kind of unfortunate. It looks like he never married or anything. But here is, now we'll just run through some of the others. General Stoneman. Stoneman was the, on the peninsula, was the man, the general that Will is originally sending messages to his camp. His camp is instrumental in the first telegraph messages from Stoneman's camp to Colonel Morrissey's headquarters, Morrissey's chief of staff to McClellan. So he mentions, there's your signal set, including rockets, flares. At night, you can signal with flares the same as you would with the flags. The Duke de Chartres, whom he and the Prince de Joinville and the Comte de Paris, and the two men on the right are American officers, but these are the French officers that Will met and mentions in his diary. And the Lacey House, Fredericksburg, Virginia. This is a field hospital. I think Clara Barton started her career there, and he was stationed near here as well. So, anyhow, that concludes the PowerPoint part of the presentation. And I don't know if where I go from here, if anybody wants.
Okay. Well, Ted, if you we're going to allow people to ask questions, and
that'd be great.
If while I'm getting that set up, if you go down to the bottom on your bottom right or bottom left and click on that start video. I don't know if it's showing or not, but if
you have start video.
Feel free to type them in the chat box at the bottom, and we'll see if we can't answer some of those questions for you.
Okay.
Right now, I'm showing you Ted's email. If you have questions for Ted later, you can always send him an email. You can also go to beside down at the bottom of the screen. If since we have a small group, if you just want to unmute yourself, you can ask Ted your questions directly. There's ways you can do it. So. Let's see, I can't see the chat box, so. I don't see any questions, Ted. So you
okay.
Must have a great job. You were doing a super job. Really appreciate that.
Okay, and thank you.
Yeah, very thorough explanation of the diary and kind of gave you a sense of like you were almost there. So that was great.
Well, thanks. Yeah, it's kind of neat. You know, I kind of, I was so disappointed to find out that he didn't live all that long and didn't have a family. Well, that's another thing. Just a quick, an appendix to this is that Anne Hendricks had given me the diary, and she was given it as a little girl. And actually, she thought originally she had bought it at a yard sale in Richmondville when she was little. And but she grew up in Cherry Valley, and she listened to the first talk I gave on this a couple of years ago. And afterwards, she came to me and she says, "I think I know where I got it." And she said, our priest, she belonged to the Episcopal Church in Cherry Valley. And she said, our priest's name was William Hill. And he was a good friend of my father. Her father was Henry Whitbeck, a local historian, well known. And why he would give a four-year-old girl a Civil War diary, I don't know, but he apparently gave it to Anne. And she always meant to do something with it, had it as an adult. And 60 years later, 60 some odd years later, she hands it to me and said, "Here, I never did anything with it." And so thank you, Anne. But so then I Googled her priest, and he retired in 1949. His name was William Hill. He was from Philadelphia, the same as Will. He was an Episcopal priest. Will was a devout Episcopal, associated with Trinity Church. And so apparently it wound up, Will didn't have any children, but it wound up in this William Hill, maybe a nephew, I would guess. And so anyhow, it came down to me through the Episcopal priest in Cherry Valley, and he gave it away in 1949. So it all came all the way up from Philadelphia to Cherry Valley. And again, I wonder, I look all over, did Will have more diaries? I would think he wouldn't just abruptly end in December after all the writing he'd done. I would hope he'd get another book and continue it, but whatever happened to them, I don't know. But his name pops up throughout history. Like I said, Culp's Hill at Gettysburg, he's at Chancellorsville, he's listed with the parties, again, by now a captain. So it's kind of a fun adventure.
So do you have any idea what enlisted or officers got paid during that time?
What they got paid?
Yes.
Yeah. Will writes everything down. He got $114 a month plus expenses. So he did all right.
Now, hey, Ted, this yes. is Sarah Keegan speaking. Hiya, Ted. What would the expenses be, you know, besides his salary?
He writes down throughout the diary various sundries every day. Officers, of course, are expected. They get a lot more money than enlisted men, but they have to buy their own uniforms. They have to buy their own weapons. They have to buy their own food. And because he's traveling a lot, he's different than any other type of military man. Where he's on the road a lot, he's got to pay for boarding, $1 a night at taverns, plus meals and sundries. When he's sent as a desert to pick up the deserters in Philadelphia, he's got to pay for train tickets for himself and two sergeants he takes and two enlisted men he takes with him. He's hitting up everybody for money, borrowing money. And he manages to pay the train fare to Philadelphia for the soldiers. And then submits the paperwork. They tell him, "Wow, this is way too big a bill. You'll have to take it to so-and-so. We can't," you know. So again, they have a lot of out-of-pocket expenses. And these guys are at one point too, it's funny, another party that Hill knows, they come in from scouting and setting up their stations. They don't know. They know that they're kind of like within Union lines. But the one thing you always do at the end of the evening, and reenactors do this, you never come into camp with a loaded weapon. You always unload your weapons by firing them. And so they come in, they set up a camp, they fire their pistols into a tree and empty it. They get arrested by General Meade himself, the head of the whole army. He comes out and he's outraged. "Who are you firing pistols within the picket line?" And they say, "Well, we didn't know." And he says, "What outfit are you with?" He says, "Well, we're not with an outfit." "How can you not be without an outfit?" You know, and he finally has to, you know, "Well, we're on special duty and everything." So, they just operate outside the army, and there's a lot of pocket expenses.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Thank you. Yep. And you always seem to find the humor in, you know, your research, you know, when you bring these characters, these, well, historical people to life.
Yeah.
And it's in it, and it's the day, you know, the day in, day out of their life that you, connections.
It's funny. He's on the train going back from Philadelphia, pining for Ada, his girlfriend, and he immediately struck with a beautiful mute with a peculiar face. And the next day I saw the mute with a peculiar face. She nodded to me. You know, I mean, it's funny. He's just, you know, it's like pining. And then all of a sudden, and then Sue, he's in love with Sue, but then he meets, you know, so it's kind of funny. A healthy young man, I guess.
Yeah, he's fickle. You know.
But the other thing I get a kick out of too, it's like, that's another thing. Theodore Davis was an artist for Harper's Weekly magazine. And I admire Theodore Davis's work. I kind of always liked him. And one night, right after the Battle of Fredericksburg, he's in a tent with Lieutenant Wiggins and another guy and him, and they're sitting in the tent. And Theodore Davis from Harper's Weekly joins him. And they sit up talking late all night. And I'm like, Theodore Davis, that's cool. He says, don't like him. You know, 3 days later, he lost his marine telescope, which cost a fortune, and he reports it to the commanding officer, Captain Cushing. Cushing says, "Well, I suggest you buy another one." He writes in the diary, "Not much, I will." You know, it's kind of fun to see. Yeah, he's just a regular guy.
Yeah, very great.
Do you know anything about Will's family? Did he mention anything in his diary about his family at all?
Well, he mentions, quite a bit. He mentions Ma a lot. He's always sending money home to Ma. You know, when he goes home, when he's arresting the deserters, basically he goes home and he sends the sergeants to find the deserters. The sergeants spend about a week drinking, which is why one of the sergeants is late for the train and they have to spend two more days. So he's just spending the day, a week at home, but he mentions Uncle Ben and Ma. And so that's where I found out he's an Episcopal, where he goes to church. And so he does mention, doesn't mention the father, but his brother Joe, who gave him the diary, he mentions Joe a lot, corresponds with Joe almost daily, sends Joe money, and so on. So I got to meet his family for 1 week in Philadelphia, in the basic.
Were there ever any women involved in the Signal Corps?
No, not that I ever found out, not that I ever discovered, no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, Ted, I noticed in some of those photographs that there were the people of color, were they, they weren't enlisted men, were they?
Oh, yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. He mentions a number of them. There's Clarkey, there's Joe, there's Black Dick. They periodically hire, you know, wherever they happen to be stationed, they just automatically hire Black servants while they're there. And, you know, they cook for them. They do a lot of stuff. One night they went to a party and it was really dark and raining and muddy. They're on horseback. They couldn't see anything. They paid one of the guys 50 cents to walk in front of them with a lantern. And so, yeah, those guys that you see in the photographs, the Black men, those are generally camp servants.
Okay.
And they actually pay them pretty well. As a matter of fact, he sold one of them a pistol for $8. So at least one of those camp servants is packing a pistol.
Well, gotcha. Very good.
Are there any other questions for Ted?
That was great. Thank you, Ted.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for listening.
Yes. Well, thank you, Ted. I really appreciate the time.
Thank you.
And I want to just quickly mention our program that's coming up in September. It's Jewish Life in Sharon Springs. It's September 13th. Yeah. It's going to be a very interesting program. It's talking about not just Jewish life, but it's going to cover what life was like in Sharon Springs during that period of time, and how the Jewish culture influenced life in Sharon Springs. So I'm going to be kind of doing a panel interview with both Henry Heinbach and also Richard Brussman, and they are both from the Brussman House, which it was a Jewish boarding house here in Sharon Springs. It's actually just right behind the Roseboro in that picture is the Roseboro in the background. And I just have thoroughly enjoyed my visits with them because they just are extremely knowledgeable in the Jewish culture, as well as the, as I said, the, you know, the, how it affected the culture here in Sharon Springs. So that will be one that I don't think you want to miss. It's a local program and going to be a very, very interesting one. Let me see here. Here's our upcoming programs after that. We have the Adler Hotel. It's the big hotel up on the hill, if you're familiar with Sharon Springs. It was quite a hotel built in the late 1920s, the last of the big hotels built here. And I'll be talking about from heyday to, unfortunately, the present day and what it looks like. So you'll get a inside tour, a very detailed inside tour of the hotel. And then Pete Lindemann is a local historian here that's written a book called They May Have Just Found James Tanner's Legs. And it's a collection of stories that he's put together of historical articles that he's a writer for the Times Journal in a local newspaper here. And he's put that together in a book. So that'll be very interesting. And then the assassination of John F. Kennedy 58 years later. That's going to be very interesting. A lot of video, a lot of photos, you know, some really interesting things. And then in December, Santa Claus, the history of the world's most legendary New Yorker. So those are our upcoming programs. I will tell you, next year we are actually doubling the amount of programs. I'm hoping to have 24 programs. We're going to go back to having in-person programs as well as online. So we're trying to schedule them so that people can still watch them if you're not from Sharon Springs. But we've had a lot of requests to go back to live programs. So we'll be presenting those and filming those as well. So you'll get to see all of them. And we'll be having a schedule that will be coming out pretty soon. I'm just finalizing the presenters. And if you have any other questions, there's our address for the Historical Society. We want to thank everyone tonight for participating. As I said, we're really enjoying these series. We've got a lot of interesting ones coming up, and you won't want to miss those. So you'll be getting notifications through Eventbrite, and you'll also be notified of the recording for the program. So thank you very much, and I hope you all have a great evening.